Without further ado, so this is Stefan Arantz, who is going to talk about a holistic view of Firefox OS, which is a new mobile operating system from Mozilla. Stefan is the security tools engineer who at Mozilla and based in Toronto. So let's give him a big round of applause.
Hello, welcome to my talk. Thank you for coming. So I'm going to talk about Firefox OS, which is a new mobile operating system for phones. My goal here is really, it's a huge topic. So my goal is really to give you a high level overview of a few things of Firefox OS that I think are interesting. Maybe get you interested in taking a look at it, picking up the source code, hopefully making a contribution. Like any Mozilla project, it's fully open source. We love contributors. So hopefully this will inspire you to participate. My agenda is really simple. I'm going to give you a bit of a tour of Firefox OS. I'm not doing any live demos. So I have some beautiful screenshots for you. I'll talk a bit about why we think this is very relevant. Then go a little deeper and talk about the technical infrastructure within the OS and how it all fits together. Talk about applications and explain how you can participate, build Firefox OS, try it out on your own phone. Let's see. So I have these two beautiful 3D renderings of two phones that run Firefox OS. But these are actually real phones. These phones are now being sold in Poland and Spain. Firefox OS is a very lively project, but last month we released version 1.0, which is put on real phones and getting in the hands of real people. This is not a this is not just something that lives in our code repository and where we all hack on. It's actually it already is a real product that people are using. These two phones are the ZTE. What's it called? The ZTE OneTouch and the Alcatel, forgot the name, but it's beautiful. It's orange, which is very appropriate for Dutch people. And they're not very high-end phones. If you're used to like a very modern iPhone or Android phone, this you go a little step back, but they're still very powerful phones. They're a big step up from feature phones, and they're very capable of running Firefox OS and browsing the web, which is what this is all about. So the whole OS is based on web technology. I'll show you a few applications that come pre-installed on the phone to give you an idea what that is like. What you see here is the contacts application and the radio application. Both phones have a built-in FM tuner. So we created a JavaScript API to control the tuner. So this tuner, this radio application is really a website. It talks to the tuner through JavaScript. It makes the needle move with CSS transitions and animations, and the presets are stored in IndexedDB, which are all web technologies. Most of them are even in your regular browser. Things like the radio API is specific for mobile devices. I'll talk a bit later about APIs and how that works. The Contacts app is also it's pretty much a full a basic web application. It consists of HTML, JavaScript, CSS. It talks to a Contacts API, which will probably also appear in web browsers soon, instead of just on a mobile device. They look like your regular native applications, but they're all web applications. Same here, email client. There's a nice map application on it. If you prefer Google Maps, the phone is perfectly capable of running web applications or websites, so you can run that too. One thing worth mentioning of the email client is that it's fully written in HTML, CSS, and JavaScript again, but it talks to IMAP servers. How does it do that? We introduced a new API for websites to make TCP connections. So it implements IMAP in JavaScript. It's a full-featured email client, all based on open web technology. We have a beautiful music player. There's a marketplace where you can discover websites and apps and download them, put them on your phone. There's a camera app, of course. Here you see a gallery, and next to it is a little image editor. Again, the editor is fully built on the open web technology. What you see in the middle is a canvas, where you can do basic things like cropping and moving the image around. The color effects are done with WebGL, which means that through a little shader language, you can apply color effects, which actually execute on the GPU. Again, this is all web technology. This application doesn't do anything specific to a phone. I think you could even run this in your browser because it uses all the APIs and technologies that any websites can use. So that's the whole idea behind Firefox OS. It's built for the web, but it's also built on top of the web. So everything you see on the phone, from lock screen to built-in applications and the little taskbar task tray that you can pull down, it's all HTML, it's all CSS and JavaScript. So why are we doing this? This is, I think, very in line with Mozilla's mission in general. Mozilla has always been about promoting openness, innovation, and opportunity on the web. And we've been very successful with that on the desktop. There are no little islands like Internet Explorer anymore. Everyone speaks the same language. We all speak HTML5. We can build apps that work on any device. As an industry as a whole, we've been lacking to do that on the mobile side of things. So this is a logical extension where Mozilla wants to push the open web even further on mobile devices. There are a bunch of things that we think are very important there that need to happen. The mobile web really isn't there yet. There are many websites that simply don't have a really nice and functional mobile web counterpart. And I think part of that is because the standards and the APIs are simply not there yet. So by doing Firefox OS, we will discover what kind of improvements these technologies need. We can push those. We can work with the W3C to create new standards to make web applications work better on mobile devices. And this will also encourage developers, hopefully, to actually start building applications. These two things have to work together, of course. We need developers to build great applications so we can discover what we need to improve in that area. And that will actually benefit not just Mozilla, it will benefit the whole industry because we have great web browsers on all mobile devices. But people are leaning more towards a much more closed app ecosystem from the two big ones at the moment, which is a shame, I think, because the web can provide a really great alternative to those. And of course, the web is open, built on open standards, so that would mean if we would all use web applications more, it would be much easier to communicate and collaborate. And we really think that the web, the open web, can be a really competitive platform in the mobile space. I think there are about 2 billion people who are not online yet, and these people will likely not buy desktop computers or laptops. These people will likely get online through a mobile device, either a phone or a tablet or something similar, form factor, mobile. And these people, we think we can provide something really great to these people in the way of a mobile operating system that's based on open web technology. We don't want these people to have to choose, do I go to Cupertino or do I go to Mountain View to pick my phone. We want these people to use open technology so that they can actually connect to each other. So I want to talk a bit about Firefox OS architecture. This is a bit more technical part of the talk, but it will still be fun. This is a very intimidating diagram of how Firefox OS works. But for now, just know that there are basically three layers. There's the operating system layer called Gonk. On top of that is a web runtime called Gecko. And on top of that, we run a UI called Gaia. And Gaia contains like everything you see on the screen of the phone, the lock screen, the home screen, etc., the built-in applications. So let me walk through this, and I will slowly build this up and explain to you how this all fits together. So when you turn on the phone starts its own bootloader, which is usually built in the phone or in the chip. And the only thing it does is it shows the logo of the phone. And then it initializes the hardware. And the next thing it really does is it loads the Linux kernel. So the phone is based on Linux. The phone is based on the Android open source project. The Android open source project is a effort by Google to fully open source Android. And we only take the lower layer of that. So we take the kernel, and we take a few extra things on top of that. And we put our own OS, we removed Android and put our own OS on that. So, which is really cool because there are literally hundreds of phones that work really well with the Android open source project. And these are all possible porting targets for Firefox OS. So as soon as the Linux kernel boots, it also loads a bunch of OEM drivers, usually for the screen or the GPU. Some of these are open source, some are closed source. It's a bit unfortunate, but that's just how the world works. And as soon as Linux has booted, it starts all kinds of services that a computer needs, like network and USB and Wi-Fi, the GPS, and it makes libraries available to, for example, do OpenGL ES and talk to lower layers of the OS. And at this point, you basically have a phone that runs Linux, and it has a bunch of basic services that can connect to the network. You can plug it into USB, and it will show up as a storage device, except there's nothing on the screen yet. So as soon as all this is running, we start up Gecko. And Gecko is basically the same web runtime that's also part of Firefox for desktop and Firefox for Android. It's the part of the browser that deals with HTML and CSS and knows how to put things on the screen and layout things. And it knows about network protocols like HTTP. And it does the rendering of an actual page on your screen. So as soon as Gecko runs on your phone, you basically have a phone now that runs Linux with some extra services and a full screen browser. And that's basically the gist of a web-based operating system. It's a full screen browser that provides services to applications you run in there, just like their normal websites. And in fact, as soon as Gecko boots, it really just loads an index.html from Gaia, which boots up the whole phone. There's an index.html in there that contains, which is a really big page, and it's like any page, it includes a bunch of JavaScript, and then it defines diffs for the lock screen and the boot logo and the home screen and all the different UI elements that are on the phone. When I first looked at this, I was like, this is really too simple. It's weird. But this is basically how the whole phone is bootstrapped. You basically just load a page in the web runtime, and there you go. You have a phone that runs the whole UI from a web page. So Gaia contains the system apps and also a bunch of built-in applications that I showed at the beginning of this presentation. And at the same level, not really part of Gaia, but next to Gaia, are user applications. You can also install your own applications on the device, which are built using the same technologies. So this is the whole stack. Every bit of it is open source, probably even including the bootloader. I haven't checked that, but probably. I'll show you later how you can actually download this. And with a couple lines of command line code, you can actually build a whole phone OS. So what's the security model of TiltDisk? Well, so as soon as Linux starts, it starts all kinds of other things. And the first thing it starts is a process called init. This also happens on your Linux desktop, and which starts all kinds of different processes, like the media server, which deals with the SD card and USB, and it installs. It starts the radio interface layer, which talks to the radio of the phone. And also starts the B2G process, which contains Gecko. So this B2G process is really the full screen browser. And as soon as you start an application in B2G, it creates a new process with a very random user ID, which we call the content process. And inside the content process, it runs that web application. All the JavaScript is executed in there. So in that way, it follows the traditional Unix model, where every app gets its own process, except they're all childs of one single B2G process. Why do we do that? It's because these applications run in something called an execution space. So it basically runs the JavaScript in there. And then every time the app needs to do something special, like use an API like IndexedDB or WebGL, or even just XML HTTP requests to make an AJAX call, those calls are not executed straight from those processes. They're all tunneled or proxied through that B2G process, which is really the traffic cop in the middle who can decide what is allowed and does this match the permission, the security model of this specific application, yes or no. And these applications also don't have, they're like traditional Unix processes, but they don't have a home directory where their data is stored. So if you start a Facebook application and you log in, it needs to store cookies somewhere for that login. And that's actually stored inside B2G. And B2G knows, oh, this application only has access to these cookies. And this application only has access to these data files for the IndexedDB or web storage. And even within the storage per app, we make sure that it really tightly follows the permission model that you're already used to from websites. So if you have a website that, for example, embeds something from Twitter or from Facebook, you can normally not access the content of those frames and the cookies of those websites that you embed. And we follow that exact same model in Firefox OS. So if you put an embedded browser in your application, that frame will actually get a little bucket somewhere where only that website can access that data. It pretty much follows the same security model as we use for websites. All right, so what about these applications? Well, I already showed you two. This is the Contacts app and the Radio app. These are built in, and these are also applications. This is the Twitter app, which is not installed. It just runs straight from Twitter, from the website, and same with Wikipedia. Again, these apps are all written using HTML, CSS, JavaScript, everything you already know when you build a website. But on top of that, we also have, of course, HTML is not just about markup. HTML is also about APIs. That's what the whole HTML5 umbrella means. So that includes WebGL, Canvas, IndexedDB, audio, video, geolocation. All those APIs are available to you when you write an application for Firefox OS. And on top of that, we also create something called Web APIs. And this is really to bridge web applications to the hardware. So for example, we have an API now that you can use to set an alarm on the device. Say, even if you put me in the background, call me after 5 minutes. Or you can ask the battery status of the device, push notifications, activities, access to the camera. So these are all new APIs that we expose to websites, to web apps running on the device. Some of these are already standardized. Some are in the process of being a real standard. And we're definitely not trying to create another island with these APIs. So we're pushing really hard to make these APIs part of HTML5, which is a really long process. I don't think that will happen in 2013, but maybe in 5 years or 10 years from now, all these APIs will be part of not just mobile devices of competing companies, but also in your regular browser. There's no reason why your regular browser shouldn't have access to TCP sockets, for example. You can build very interesting web applications then, of course. So there's basically two types of applications. We have what we call hosted applications, and these are really more like glorified bookmarks or websites, as you know them. And we have packaged applications, which are websites that are simply zipped together. And they can be downloaded to the device, or they come pre-installed on the device. And it's really our answer to have a good solution for offline applications, where you can just grab the whole thing and take it with you and everywhere. I don't think it's a solution that will last very long. There's some work underway to really make the difference between hosted and packaged much smaller. I'm not going to talk much about that. Packaged applications come in two flavors, privileged or plain. I'll explain what that means. So hosted apps are really just websites. But these websites, for example, here you see the Twitter application, which runs really great on this device. And the only thing you need to do to turn your website into a hosted app is you put a little web application manifest file on your website. It's a little JSON file, and what you put in there is the name of the application that you want to see on the home screen, a version, and a link to an icon that we need to display, and the path to the initial page that we need to display when you tap the icon. So when you do this, you already have something that people can install on the device. Again, it's not really installing; it's more like a glorified bookmark. But you can give it a real name and an icon. So these hosted apps can be bookmarked on the home screen. They'll get an icon. But they're also a little closer to more native apps because, for example, they can use web activities. Web activities are really cool. I took this picture earlier with the built-in camera app. Now when I hit that little the little share button, the second from the right, I get a list of applications on my phone that can share this image. And there are built-in applications like email and wallpaper and the SMS application. But and these are all applications packaged and installed on my phone. But Twitter also appears there. That's pretty cool because Twitter is really just a website. So with web activities, you can actually make hosted applications, websites, more like first-class citizens of your phone, because they can actually interact with other applications. So what I can do now is I can select Twitter, and what happens is the Twitter website will open, and it will know that I wanted to share that image. And I can type a message and share that. How this works is really simple. You just add a little activities section to your manifest file, and you say, I support the share activity for everything that looks like an image. And when the user wants that, open my application at /compose/tweet. And through a little JavaScript API, Twitter can now ask, hey, was I opened from a web activity? And if so, what's the image that I need to share? How do you install applications? You can upload them to the Firefox Marketplace, which is really the Mozilla hosted app store. This may sound weird, but it's actually a really good way to make your app discoverable. We have a great search engine there. It's also indexed by the phone, actually. If your app has Twitter in the name and you search for Twitter on your phone, it will actually show you, hey, there's an app on the Marketplace that you might want to install. But you can also install it on your own website. All you need to do is you create a little button or a link that calls an API called window.navigator-apps.install, and you point it to that manifest file, and now your phone knows, oh, hey, this is a hosted app that I can install on my phone. So packaged apps are really, really similar, except you zip it all up. So this is a zip file for a little game, and as you can see, it contains the index.html and scores.html. It also contains the code and the game engine and a bunch of images and an icon. You put it all in a zip file, and now your phone can download that whole zip at once, and it will store it and persist it. Which means it's better suited for offline use. So if you turn off network on your phone, you're in the subway, this app will still have all its content available and can easily run. So as I said, there are two packaged applications. One is Plain, and Plain is really just more like a website. Doesn't do anything special. Like if you want to use the TCP sockets API, that would make you a privileged application for which the user also has to give approval for that app to actually use that API. And Plain can be installed from anywhere, just like hosted apps, compared to privileged apps that need to be signed and go through our malware detection on the marketplace first before you can install them on your phone. But the advantage of privileged apps is that they can use all the web APIs, so they can really integrate with the phone and be really interesting applications. For example, they can also request special permissions. Like if your application wants to store things on the SD card that's in the phone, you can ask a permission for that. Also in the manifest file. And these are things that privileged apps can do. So the easiest way to develop and test apps is through the simulator. We have an add-on for Firefox that allows you to run applications in Firefox, so you don't necessarily have to have a phone. This is just the main screen of the this is a very boring main screen of the add-on, but what you get is basically you get a pop-up window, the same dimensions of a phone, and your app runs in there. And we emulate emulate a lot of web APIs that are usually available to your phone. So this is a great way to, if you're writing an app, this is a great way to get a feel of how it actually looks and feels on a phone. But have the comfort of doing it all on your laptop or desktop. Especially because, you know, also at the bottom you can see our developer tools, so you have access to the JavaScript console and the debugger and the profiler and the style editor and all the beautiful things that we're very rapidly releasing in the developer tools. It's also very easy to push an application to your phone from these tools. You can basically just click a button, and if you have the phone connected through USB, it will also upload the application to your phone, so you can test there too. Of course, your Mac or your PC will be like 1,000 times faster than a phone, so it's very smart to also test on a real phone. So like any Mozilla project, Firefox OS is fully open source. In the beginning I said it's a project by Mozilla, but it's like any other project, it's really a project from Mozilla and contributors. We have a lot of third-party contributors already, just ordinary people who are interested in contributing something, making a little fix or an improvement. But interestingly, we also have we're getting huge contributions from large telcos, like for example Telefonica, who are putting insane amounts of resources in Firefox OS. And nothing of that is secret, it's all very transparent, it all happens through GitHub. you can clone the repository and start fixing bugs or making improvements and submit a pull request to get those changes in the main product. The community, as with other Mozilla projects, is very open. What most people don't know is that you can absolutely participate with the development of Firefox OS on IRC and mailing lists, but you can also you can join almost any meeting that we're having. The Firefox OS team meets a couple times a week. You can always dial in through Skype for free, or even just join the video conference. It's a really great way to find out what's going on, what people are working on, and what the current events are. Everything is, of course, on our public wiki, meeting notes, documentation, design plans, timelines, everything is there. And there's also a lot of discussion and planning happening in Bugzilla. Often, if you're interested in maybe participating, it's good to find like the master bug of a specific feature or improvement and then look at the dependencies, which are usually much more bite-size ready because it's split up in smaller parts. As I said, so it's a fully open source project. The code is on GitHub. If you want to build Firefox OS, you basically check out the code, which is basically a bootstrap repository. It takes like 2 seconds. Then when you configure the code for a specific target platform, it will actually grab all the code that's relevant for that platform, which can take up to 2 hours because it's a lot of code. And then you can build, we made all kinds of nice shortcuts for you that should just work on most Linux flavors and Mac OS X. So you can very easily build and flash Firefox OS to your phone or your device. You can also say, I want to flash everything or just Gecko because I made a change there, or maybe only the calendar application because I've been experimenting with something there. And we actually have quite a few targets. The two phones that I showed on the first slides have code names Hamachi and Buri. We also have the Keon and Peak, which are the Geeks phone phones. Those are more like developer phones for Firefox OS, which you can order from a Spanish company. But because Firefox OS is built on top of the Android project, it also very easily ports to popular Android phones. So I think we have about a dozen phones that are part of the standard build. Some of these are like a little older, and you can get them for cheap on eBay. If you're interested in playing with Firefox on a real phone, you can get one of those and make a build for that. We also have an emulator that runs on Macs and Linux, which is really cool to just do all your work on a single machine. And interestingly, we also work really well on the Panda board, which is an embedded ARM system. I think in Mozilla, it's mostly used by QA and automation teams. But you can do some interesting things with it. It's very similar to the Raspberry Pi port. You can, for example, use that to turn your Raspberry Pi into a digital signage application kind of thing. Because what you basically get is a full screen web browser, and you can change the whole UI of the phone. And if you don't want it to be a phone, you can turn it into a beautiful sign or anything you want. There's a whole bunch of things that we can totally use some help with. I highlighted the security items because that's mostly what I work on. We would love for people to take a really deep look at Firefox OS and find or fix security bugs. I'm not saying there are any bugs, but what we call bugs are also just feature requests and improvements to make the device more secure. If you're interested in that kind of work, absolutely take a look and see what you can do. We also do a lot of security reviews of new code that enters Firefox OS or built-in applications. And again, everything we do is public and open. You can participate in it. You can easily join a security review meeting if you see on the wiki that we're going to look at the Bluetooth stack and you love messing with Bluetooth, please join us and help us out there. There's all kinds of cool things that you can do. You can port to a new device, you can help localizing, write documentation, participate on the mailing list, express your frustrations with the very first release, suggest improvements. There's lots of stuff to do. It's a very lively project. I think about probably 100 people work on it in total. It's very high-paced. Well, I started a bit sooner than I thought, but thank you for listening. And these are some places where you can find more information. There's a lot of information on MDN, developer.mozilla.org. It's our developer network. Not just about developing applications, but also developing for Firefox OS, so like work on the OS itself. All the code is on GitHub. All the bugs are in Bugzilla. We have a bunch of IRC channels where you can hang out and ask questions. There's always someone there in some time zone who can help you out or answer questions or ask me anything. You can send me an email or just find me on the conference here. That's it.
Okay, so we still have about 10 minutes. Should we take some questions?
Sure.
So if anyone's interested, please come to the mic in the center.
Hi.
Hello.
I got basically two questions. The first one is, does the phone user have control over the security settings? So basically, can I deny the Facebook app access to my address book and still use the application?
Yeah, we show the same door hangers that you get in Firefox. So if an application wants geolocation access, for example, you'll have to approve that. And those settings come back into the settings application where you can see the decisions that you've made in the past and you can change those if you wish.
Yeah, it's still use the application. It's not a yes or no and drop out.
I think for packaged apps, it's very much like Android at the moment where when you install the app, you can you have to approve the permissions that the app requests. So it might be like a blanket approval.
Okay. And the second one is, where do I get one of these t-shirts?
I didn't bring any, I'm sorry.
Okay, thank you.
Could you give more details about the privileged app process? Like how does the progress go to...
You mean to get an app on the store?
To get a privileged app. How does the checking go? What do you guys check? You're talking about malware check?
Sorry?
You were talking about a malware check? Is there more? Or?
Yeah, so when you submit an app to the Firefox Marketplace, because it's written in HTML and CSS, we can look at the source code. So we have a bunch of static code analysis tools that actually look through your code and look for things that we think are naughty or you shouldn't do. And then if one of those... if we find some of those things, we do a manual check and see what's going on there. It's just to prevent malware applications. Yeah. I must say the approval process is completely driven by contributors. There's not like a Mozilla committee or something that's approving apps. If you're interested in maybe becoming part of the approval team, well, I shouldn't call it the approval team. It's more like a review team. You can totally sign up for it and be part of that.
You said that you were aiming at making all the APIs for all the peripherals, etc., standardized. So I presume you're hoping that other browsers will implement them too.
Yep.
Aren't you afraid that, for example, those APRs are going to get into, for example, Android phones, and people can just people then are like, oh, I can buy either a Firefox phone, which runs only Firefox applications, or I can buy this Android phone, on which I can also install Firefox applications. So they will always take the Android phone. Isn't that something you're worried about?
No, not at all, because that's the success of the mission. If other phones implement these APIs, then we have moved the web forward.
Fair enough. Yeah. Thanks.
It's really not about... It's not about selling phones. It's about making the mobile web better. And if we can do that through these phones that we happen to support, then that's great. But if the long-term goal is that all devices like iOS and Android also support these APIs, I think the Ubuntu people who are also building a new phone have already expressed that they're very interested in this. And on Ubuntu, you can build applications either in Qt or in HTML. And they're definitely going to support a bunch of these APIs.
Yeah. Hi. Do you collaborate with the Python project, which also uses web technologies for its OS?
No, I don't think so.
You didn't understand? Sorry?
Sorry, I couldn't exactly
hear. Do you collaborate with the Python project?
The Python project?
Python, yeah.
No, I don't think we're doing anything with that.
Because they are building APIs to control the phone thanks to web technologies, so it's quite the same goal.
If it's similar to like a higher level framework like PhoneGap, then I think companies like that are trying to support Firefox OS by simply making Firefox OS one of their supported platforms.
No.
Okay. I will Google what it is. And catch me later. We can talk about it.
Okay. Thanks.
Oh, hello. Well, actually, really easy because it's just on GitHub, so you just search GitHub for Tizen.
Yeah.
But anyway, I was wondering why would you have a version in the web app manifest at all instead of like using HTTP headers, so like expires and last modified, because then you would not need a version at all because HTTP also already specifies if it's the latest version or not.
Yeah, that's a good question. I don't know. I think the HTTP headers are more time-based at the moment. And the version number is really... it might just be more like a visual indication to the user. This is version 1.0, because users are familiar to that.
Yeah, but does the user really want to bother with all of that?
I don't know. We can look at the source code and see how that actually works.
Okay.
Yeah.
Hi. Two questions. First of all, are you also planning on extending the mobile Firefox app on where it's available on the other platforms, on Android, iOS, and Windows Mobile, I think, I'm not sure, that it will also support the extended API and the capability to run Firefox OS apps? That's my first question. Answer that first. Okay.
Okay, yeah. So, I don't think we want to create another island. So really the goal is that these applications are not going to be Firefox OS applications, they're going to be web applications, and they should run anywhere. Of course, it's easier for us to also implement these APIs on Android, and I think we're already doing that for a whole bunch of them, where Android allows that. But yeah, the goal is really to create a new platform across any browser.
All right, thank you. Second question, will the Firefox OS, just like Android, eventually release an NDK for native development, will Firefox OS also somehow allow a sandboxed way of running native code, or are you sufficiently confident in the efficiency of your JavaScript engine?
Yeah.
Will it always match or equal or approach native performance?
Yeah, I don't think we're super comfortable yet, but we're getting there. Like, if you've seen the Unity game engine demo that we do now on Firefox for desktop, where we use sm.js to execute a more assembly-like JavaScript, experiments like that really push the boundaries of what you can do with JavaScript. And we're totally trying to do the same thing on mobile and prevent having to open up a native SDK. I think native is totally against the point of this. So, yeah.
And are you also already looking into the new 64-bit ARM architecture to have it ready by the time that those are coming to market?
I don't know. I think the 64 ARM stuff is only for servers at the moment. But it will slowly move to mobile. Yeah.
In about 2 years, maybe. Yeah.
Yeah, probably. Yeah. No, we're on top of that. We made the move to ARM for Android, so we have a very solid foundation on ARM, and 64-bit is just the next step for that. Yeah.
All right. Finally, one short just appeal. Please, when you're developing Firefox OS, please give the support for newer TLS versions, 1.1, 1.2. Please give it a higher priority.
Yeah, 1.2.
This is as a Firefox user. I'm very frustrated with the lack of development on that front.
So I think 1.2 is already in Firefox nightly. Firefox OS is a little bit behind. Gecko in Firefox OS is a little behind what we have on desktop, but we're trying to catch up with that. We're going to do the same rapid release cycles for Firefox OS and integrate the latest Gecko code back in there, which will include TLS 1.2, actually.
I asked too many questions than I should, but thanks. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome. Oh, more questions. Hello.
First, thank you for this awesome project. Second, I was wondering if there is any plan or way to use other languages than JavaScript on Firefox OS?
No, I don't think so. No. JavaScript is really the one universal language that ties the web together. What's very popular is to put something on top of JavaScript, like CoffeeScript or any of the other flavors that you can compile down to JavaScript. But no, it's going to be web technology. Yeah. But JavaScript is evolving. I mean, we're getting more and more interesting new features in JavaScript, and we're closely following that, of course. We're a big part of that, actually. Yeah.
Hi. My question is, can you actually also show it on the phone, how it works? Do you have it running already? Or?
Yeah, if you catch me outside of the tent, I'll show you a phone. I have an older phone with me,
okay.
But you can totally play with it if you want.
Just sure. So you understand how the responsiveness is, etc.
Yeah.
And the second thing, what I don't really understand, if I would develop an app for, say, an iPhone, it would get installed, it's my source code.
Yep.
Say, if I now would like to develop the same app on Firefox OS, and it would get installed, I just see all the manifest and the,
yep,
the JSON script, etc. It's something that everybody can view and see. Why would I want to have an app for which people pay on the iPhone? Why would I want to port it to Firefox OS?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think the dynamics of selling an app on the web are simply different than closed app stores that are protected with DRM. We don't know yet. I think right now there are about 1,500 applications on the Firefox marketplace. Lots of little experiments or more serious apps. I think in the coming year we have to see how that will work for developers. You can of course do things like run an obfuscator over your code. You could compile it down to asm.js, which is more assembly-like and hard to decompile if you're really worried about that. I don't really have an answer to that, except that the dynamics of web applications are just very different because it's all it's all source code. Yeah.
All right. Thanks.
It's also the power of it, because you can, in theory, you can take a website and learn from it and make changes maybe.
Right, so that's quite a long session we've had. So let's give thanks to Stefan again, and remember to meet him at a media cafe if you have more questions. Thank you, Stefan.